For those of us who work in the service of public education, we recognize that one of the museum's greatest strengths are the many people that who provide our programs and who attend our programs. There are visitors and there are teachers. Over the many years that I've worked here, I've been impressed by the vast diversity of Native people that come through our doors. They speak hundreds of different languages. They live in places as close as a few blocks away and as far as the northern reaches of the Arctic and the southern parts of South America. They have hair and eye colors that span the global spectrum. They are tall, short, and everything in between. Tonight's conversation is about a group of our constituents that we're calling African Native American, the blend of African American and Native American. This identity, as many of you probably know, has been complicated by the limitation of census categories, racism, national policies, and personal assumptions about identity based on skin color. The conversation tonight between the co-curator of the exhibit IndiVisible African Native American Lives in the Americas, Dr. Gabby Tayac, and Dr. Heriberto Dixon will address some of the issues of identifying as a mixed race person and the work that lies ahead of us to better understand the ways in which we must challenge misconceptions about what it means to be African Native American. Now, before we get the conversation started, I just want to remind everybody that it is being webcast, and we will have a question and answer period at the conclusion of this evening's program. We do have a mic here, and we ask that if you have a question at the end of the program to please come up and stand by the mic to ask your question so that everybody can hear who's watching us online. I also ask that at this time, everybody turn off your cell phones or anything that makes noise. With that, and finally, there's a book signing at the conclusion of the program upstairs on the second floor, so you can go into the shop and get a copy of the catalog and have Gabby Tayac sign one of your books. So right now, it gives me great pleasure to introduce Dr. Gabrielle Tayac, co-curator of IndiVisible African Native American Lives in the Americas. In turn, she will introduce Dr. Heriberto Dixon. Gabby is a member of the Piscataway Nation. She is a historian with our museum and is based in Washington, D.C. Her areas of speciality include international human rights and the Native peoples and histories of the Chesapeake Bay region where her family is from. She's currently curating an exhibit about the Native people of this region. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Tayac.
Thank you. I'd like to extend my greetings and thanksgivings to all of you, to my colleagues here at the National Museum of the American Indian, and also a special greeting and thanks and offering to the Native people of this land, of this area. Thank you so much for having us here in your homeland, and also to extend, of course, a congratulations to Shinnecock on recognition. So I just wanted to acknowledge that. Before I go any further, sitting in the middle of our audience is the person who started this project, Penny Williams. I would like, Penny, if you could please stand up. I would like to welcome you here and thank you for your work. It is my great honor and privilege to introduce Professor Heriberto Dixon. He's emeritus at SUNY New Paltz of African American Native American ancestry. He's a member of the Saponi Tribal Nation of Ohio, where he is a historian, genealogist, and distinguished elder. He is responsible for writing tribal history and reclaiming the Saponi's language and ceremonies. Professor Dixon is a graduate of Queens College, the Business School at Columbia, and the University of Pittsburgh. His time is dedicated to preserving the rich history of his people and to helping others discover their connections to Native American ancestry. His research has appeared in the New York State Encyclopedia and the Smithsonian Institute's Handbook of North American Indians. I'd like to welcome you tonight here, Dr. Dixon. There's somebody else who is not in the room, but who was a great pathbreaker for us in this way of thinking, in terms of uncovering and making visible what has been invisible, which has been told in our families, submerged in our lives, is part of this land and landscape. And that was Dr. Jack Forbes. I have a quote here from him. He passed about exactly a year ago, and he was a great wayfinder in this thinking. I have a quote, actually, that Dr. Dixon has graciously passed on for me to recall from him, where he says, "You can't tell who people are by merely looking at them." And with that, I would like to open our way of thinking and to have Dr. Dixon give our greeting and orientation for this evening.
We begin with the words before all else. We give thanks to the Creator. Now, these were the first words that I learned in Seneca Cayuga some years ago. Nyawe means I am grateful. And I like to say I am grateful more than saying thanks. Thanks gets to be used and misused quite a bit. But to say that I'm grateful means I humble myself to something that's greater than myself. And I give blessings and I give thanks and for all the gifts that I've received, because we cannot take anything for granted. And we take things for granted, that's when we go awry. So the Iroquois people have the custom of beginning all their ceremonies, all their meetings, with the words before all else, which can be many hours long. They go through a great deal of detail, thanking everything, from the grass, from the water, the bushes, the trees, the animals, the sky, the birds, everything imaginable, the four messengers, and the one above. So we always want to be mindful of how little we really are ourselves, and how much do we owe to a power that's greater than ourselves. And the second thing is that when some of you will recognize the phrase, I'm sure, that may the Lord watch over us while we're absent one from another. That reminds us that while we're absent from one another, things happen to us. And that before we can conduct business, we need to clear up ill feelings. We need to clear up grief, especially. And in the Iroquois tradition, we recognize the words of condolence. And I will just use the three bare words of condolence, because there are many words of condolence. And I dedicate this to memory of Jack Forbes, who was a pioneer, who was a man well ahead of his times in pointing a road. And our road has been that we've had these stories and we've been dismissed out of hand. It took a generation until we began to get educated, getting the advanced degrees, learning the methods, and being able to contest what had been told to us by using the same methodology that had been used against us. And so Jack Forbes was a pioneer in creating this way. And we may refer to him many times and often. And he was an inspiration for me. So the three words of condolence. Now, when you have condolence, you have two sides. Duality is typical in most Native American cultures. You have the two sides of a coin. And they're not seen necessarily as good and evil, simply as two sides. Like you say, there's two sides to every story. And when someone is suffering grief, that person and their immediate family are grief-stricken. And you need someone who is not under the immediate spell of that grief, called the clear-minded ones, to lift this burden of grief from them so that they can return to a clear mind. So, and this is done with the use of wampum strings. Most people have heard of wampum. Wampum is more than just money. that when someone rises and holds the wampum strings, it's like swearing on a Bible, that what you say is the truth. And so the three words of condolence go as follows. When one is suffering from a great grief, great sorrow, the eyes become clouded with tears and one cannot see clearly. With this first string, I wipe away the tears from your eyes so that you can again see the beauty of creation. In like manner, when one is suffering from this grief, the ears become stopped up and one cannot hear. So therefore, the second string, I opened your ears so that you can again hear the beauty of the music of the birds. And in like fashion, when one is suffering from this great grief, the throat becomes clogged, choked, and one cannot breathe, and one cannot speak the words of one's heart. So with this third string, I open your throat so that you may breathe again and speak the words of your heart, and that you can appreciate the beauty of creation, and you can go on with life. And that's where I'd like to start.
Thank you. You know, when you bring up these words of condolence and talk about lifting the obstacles so that we can see maybe what is there or what we would like to see again, in many ways, the project of IndiVisible, people kept talking about how it was a healing, how it was lifting out to see something that they had wanted to talk about for so long and maybe had been talking about more quietly, but to bring this up. And it also brought up a lot of feelings of grief and needs to heal that out. And I'm just wondering what you may be seeing, that where we are now, that it's come to this point that so many people are ready to be able to talk about this hidden history, both personally, in our society, in so many places. So I just was wondering what you're thinking about, why we're at that point now where we're ready to engage in this conversation.
Well, there's a cliche, I guess, that says nothing is more powerful than an idea whose time has come. And I think the idea has come because of what we've been able to do for ourselves, as I mentioned before. If I didn't have a PhD, and Gabby, if you didn't have a PhD, and you would say something like this, people would quickly dismiss us and say, oh, you really don't know what you're talking about. But when you've gone to the same sources that they've gone to and say, look, you missed this, and you missed that, and you overlooked that, and you erased that, what can they say? You use their tools against them. Another thing that's a great importance is the civil rights movement. This is big because it freed people from the caste system in the South by law and in the North by custom. Just read an interesting book about the Indian civil rights movement in Alabama and Louisiana. And it owed a lot to the civil rights, which then wiped out this legal category of the one-drop rule, which Indian people were held captive to, that because they call it a biracial system, just white and non-white. And if you're not white, then you're non-white. And in that category, it was not limited to African Americans. A big mistake that a lot of scholars make when they go back into history, and I'm a stickler for this, use the original terms that were in place. Don't reinterpret those in a revisionist way. And the word of art from the first census, US census in 1790, was for other whites and other free people. That's what it said. Later on, they began to talk about free people of color. Now, you read later authors, and they collapse all of that, conflate all of that, and to make them African Americans. Not true. Who were the free people of color? Clearly, they were African Americans. Clearly, they were mixed heritage. They were Indians. And which might surprise a lot of people, is they had a lot of Mediterranean Europeans and Mediterranean North Africans in that category of free people of color. See, they were off-white, not white enough, and they didn't attain the privilege of whiteness. Now, there's a whole study now, a field of whiteness, what whiteness means. And Kathy, my wife and I, we've just read a couple interesting books about how the Irish became white, how the Jews became white folks. I guess someone will write a book soon on how the Italians became white, because these people, when they first came here, were not considered white. And so this category was very elastic, and I think we need to go back and deconstruct that those categories to see the people that were actually in those categories. So the things, and we're living in a very exciting moment that there's a lot of scholarship being done. American history has not been done yet. Most people in this room understand that American history. What we were treated to was the Anglo-American propaganda of manifest destiny. They didn't even consider the Spanish. For Southern history, it's inescapable that you talk about the Spaniards. The Pardo expedition and all those people, Ayong and all these other people who came and settled as far north as North Carolina in what they call La Florida. And they were on the land. They brought people of African ancestry and other ethnicities as well who were on the land. But these things were just wiped out because they had a different tale, the tale of the manifest destiny, that is the manifest destiny in this country for the Anglo-Saxon people to overspread the continent. And if you didn't meet that requirement, you were just conveniently left out of history. But now that we're able to write our own history, more people are joining us and sort of getting on this bandwagon, because my interest is in Indian slavery. When I say Indian slavery, people never heard that Indians were enslaved. And they were. And it didn't end. And the convenient date for slavery in America is 1619, when those people came off the boats. They weren't even slaves, they were indentured. And after their indenture was over, they went on, like a fellow by the name of Johnson, bought land and bought indentured servants himself. That was a late date as far as Indian slavery was practiced in this country. We could go on with this forever, but I think that will give you an introduction that the time is now, the history is being written, and this is an exciting time, very exciting time.
Right. You know, when you've been looking into the history of the Tutelo people,
yeah,
bringing that back, I have to say, you know, my areas in Chesapeake, and I'd been following Piscataway and Kanoi up into Pennsylvania and through the colonial period, and hearing about Tutelo, and just like many other of the people that are looking at this, thinking, well, Tutelo has disappeared, has vanished. And then I heard about the work that you had done to bring the people back together, and I'm wondering about how you started that trail, and if you saw race playing into the submergence of Tutelo people over time as
okay.
well.
Okay, as a native of the eastern part of the United States, you know about the Big Erasure. Mm-hmm. I call it Big Eraser. And that Native people, after the Removal Act, 1830, it was just assumed there are no more Indian people east of the Mississippi. Mm-hmm. So we don't have to provide a category for them. And so they were subsumed in this category of free people of color. Then that, and what's interesting, you can chronologize certain individuals, not away on a reservation, for instance. As long as they were on the reservation, they were Indian. As soon as they left in the reservation, for whatever reason, they became free people of color. Then finally they became African Americans, same people. And you can see it in the lifetime of a single individual, this journey, it changes in classification. Now, with regards to the Tutelo people, a fascinating study. The best place to begin is in your own family history. And so I started as a favor to my mother. My mother was very interested in knowing her background. And we had traditions in our family of Indian heritage. But you know, we kind of had to keep it hush hush because it wasn't very popular, and people, oh, you're just making this up, and you know, all this kind of craziness. But I got information from my elders, 1977 to be exact, and they clarified and gave me places to look. And when I went to those places, I found what I was looking for. For instance, that in my mother's case, where she came from, was one of the places where one of the disbanded bands, if I can use the word disbanded bands, mm-hmm. of Saponi people had settled around Henderson in what is now Vance County, North Carolina. And they settled on a property of a man named William Eaton, who had been their commander during the French and Indian War. And they stayed there. And they lived in an interesting place called Nutbush Creek. Everybody's heard of the Tina Turner connection. Well, Tina is a bullock, and we're bullocks from Nutbush Creek in North Carolina.
Okay.
So there's a suggestion that her folks, in fact, one of her ancestors appears in our family genealogy, but fell off. So could he have gone, and they've named Nutbush after the community that they lost. But we established that there was a Saponi origin there. Then I met Rick Hathcock. His wife had done some great genealogical stuff. Mm-hmm. And they told me the story of the migration of some of the Saponi people to a place called Shamokin, which is now Sunbury, Pennsylvania. Now, one of the first things we had to deal with was the names. See, the same people may have different names in different locality. And at this time, at an earlier time, in Virginia, North Carolina, a bunch of Siouan-speaking people were called Saponi Nation when they were placed on a reservation called Fort Christanna. Now, when they came north to Shamokin and adopted in 1753 by the Cayuga, they went by the Iroquois designation of Tutelo. Now, we don't know what Tutelo means. I've been trying to track down the origins of Tutelo. Kathy points out that it has a similar sound to Tupelo. So in the Tupelo tree, so there may be some kind of connection. It's something that we're trying to decipher. But the Iroquois called all the Siouan people, including the Catawba, as Tutelo. And so that's the name that we acquired when we moved up into New York State. Now, what we were lucky is that the town of Ithaca had some archaeologists, and they discovered some artifacts. They did some shovel excavation and found where the main Tutelo village might have been in the south of Ithaca at the Cayuga Lake inlet. Now, when Sullivan's army came through in 1779, they destroyed everything. And the people then reconvened, reassembled at Fort Niagara. And then they fought in the American Revolution with the Cayuga, because we're always grateful to the Cayuga for taking our people in. We were like the prodigal son that we were taken in. So we had this debt of gratitude to Cayuga people. I was able to present this belt to the Six Nations in Canada and to offer our thanks for what they had done for our ancestors. Now, at the end of the American Revolutionary War, a bulk of the people went into Six Nations Reserve and settled there. Now, I looked at the other migration of those who stayed in place in Virginia and in the Carolinas. And currently, I'm tracing those that went down into the Creek, Choctaw, and Seminole Nations. So it's an ongoing study of the migrations of how people moved and how they tried to survive in any conditions that they could. Mm-hmm. So that's briefly what we've been trying to establish with the Tutelo reconnection. And the reconnection has been very interesting because some people didn't know it on either side, mm-hmm. and find that you have relatives that you didn't even know about. So, right. So that's pretty nice.
Right. You know, you were talking before about manifest destiny, and that really links into the dispossession of Indigenous peoples, and how I think especially, you know, a lot of times people wonder about the Indivisible Project, and it's sometimes of more interest to, you know, African American community people, where they have this story of the history and their lineage about their Native American history. With Native Americans, it seems sometimes to be more complicated or more worrisome, but at the same time, it's really about, and this is what my thinking was that we have to understand that by racializing Native peoples, it was an instrument for losing our lands.
Mm-hmm,
exactly. You know, that you see that is something that we don't really see in history. It's not really talked about, but it's this huge process, especially on the Atlantic seaboard, of how people have lost their land, their tribal status when they get racialized. And that is something that I think makes it very important for Native communities to get to start to deal with this kind of history.
Yeah, well, let me begin with the racialization. Mm-hmm. What we mean by racialization is, and you've probably heard this, are you a full blood? That's the only group that ever gets asked that question, are you a full blood? What does that mean? It means nothing, okay? This is part of how this system structured itself on the perception of race, so it could therefore stratify and exclude rather than include people.
Mm-hmm.
And then it works in insidious ways. Let me give you an example. Starting with Thomas Jefferson and his notes on Virginia, and when he begins to talk about the Virginia tribes, he maligns them. He says, oh, they're so mixed now, they show more Negro than Indian, there's hardly any Indian left. Mm-hmm. This was an excuse now to drive them off the reservations, because according to Jefferson, they're no longer Indian enough to hold on to the land. So you have a double whammy here. You have the one drop rule. Now the one drop rule is interesting. If I give you a cup of hot milk and pour in one drop of coffee, have you got coffee or do you still have milk? But now clearly you understand that when we talk about coffee, but why does it apply to human beings? But it was a convenient way of creating a caste system to rule people out of contention. So therefore, if you have one drop, you're all black. If you have one black in tribe, you're black by association. And that's a very convenient way of moving people off the reservation. Mm-hmm. So in defense, the Gengaskins and Delmarva, the Nottoways, who I mentioned before, they were more mixed than some of the other tribes, and they lost their reservation as a result. The Pamunkey and Mattaponi were able, quick enough, to kind of distance themselves, to go through their ethnic cleansing,
yeah. And
were able to hold on to their lands today. So part of it was a defensive mechanism in order to hold on to the land. But then it's applied against even the tribes, especially if you go out in Oklahoma, and they make a distinction. Well, if you have a certain percentage of white ancestry, you're considered competent. If you don't, you're incompetent. And then the idea of having you to do your constitution so that you define yourself out of existence. We're talking earlier about a lecture I heard by an Osage lawyer. They had the Osage and the Kaw were the only two tribes that kept reservations when Oklahoma became a state. When Oklahoma became a state, Oklahoma's a fascinating place in terms of contradictions. All the other tribes were abolished. Cherokee, Choctaw, Chickasaw, all of them were abolished. They had business councils, but they didn't have any tribal structure. But they had set, the Osage had set their requirements of blood quantum so high that when they realized they were running out of members and they wanted to call back a committee to revise their constitution, they couldn't get a quorum because they had defined themselves out of existence. So this is how this works. Now, usually how dissent works is that it comes down without reference to race. Now, if I'm a Shinnecock sitting out there in Long Island, like my wife has it in her ancestry, goes back unbroken. Okay, now the fact that some racial lines may have been crossed, that doesn't change her blood relationship to those ancestors. But the way racism comes in and says, well, if you're black, you have no right to ancestry. Mm-hmm. And so what we're beginning to do now is to challenge that and saying, no, the rule is the line of descent, the line of heritage. And if one can show that, then why should one be excluded because of race? And the BAR, the Bureau of Acknowledgement and Research, talking about, they'd say that in one breath, race is not a factor in acknowledging or recognizing tribes, but yet it is, because they use that against. And as we sit here and I'm thinking about the Shinnecocks after many, many years, who their records go back to the Dutch, unbroken, and the difficulty that they had. And can you tell me it's not because of race? And I think because Obama is in the White House must have helped them quite a bit, because people would have been kind of embarrassed to kind of raise the racial issue in an Obama White House. If someone else had been in the White House, it would have been sweeping under the carpet kind of thing. So race plays into all these considerations, and the groups in the South, the Houma, the Moa, Choctaw, they all have all these difficulties because how they were classified earlier. Now, if anybody's doing any research here, I know Ruth Hunt is here and we've talked about this. The first thing I was told in doing this research is disregard racial designation. Disregard them because they are not reliable. Okay? Jack Forbes is certainly, if you go to Jack Forbes, he'll tell you a lot of the tricks that they play. Now, for instance, if an enumerator goes out and returns people as Indians or returns people as Negroes. See, he's paid based on the people that he returned in his report, his enumeration. He was paid a higher amount for recording Negroes than he was for Indians. So where's his bias? He's trying to maximize the money he gets. He's gonna make as many people as Negro as possible. And so Jack Forbes was fond of saying, they're always losing Indians, but finding Negroes. And this is how this insidiousness. So when you look for your ancestors in your census, I look for three things. The surnames, because we were lucky that people adopted European surnames very early, 1700s. Look at the surnames. Look how they cluster. Look at the time and look at the place. And you can backstop this with some of the studies that was done by Gilbert and some other people with the Smithsonian that identify these communities, identify these names in these communities, and there you have a way of designating. Also, you can turn their arms against them. I'm reminded of this book by Gloria Bird and Susan Harjo in Reinventing the Enemy's Language. Mm-hmm. And there's this terrible man, Plecker. You remember Plecker, don't you? Well, Plecker was so adamant, he was part of the eugenics movement that had relationships with Nazi Germany, and he was not a very savory character. And he personally changed the designation of people themselves. If it had Indian, he made it C for color, okay? Then he listed county by county the people who would be trying to pass as Indians. That's a blueprint, see? Because, like Shakespeare said, the lady doth protest too much. So you can take his own list, and if your family is included in that list, you could be relatively sure that they were Indian.
Mm-hmm. Right. And Walter Plecker was the head of the Bureau of Vital Statistics in Virginia, who passed the Racial Integrity Act. And so it was actually outlawed to designate yourself as an Indian, or for midwives or any official record keepers in Virginia, it was prohibited to identify oneself as an American Indian in Virginia from 1924 until 1967, when Loving versus Virginia overturned the anti-miscegenation laws. So this, you know, has huge impact, and maybe we're just at the point where we have a generation that's been born after that era to be able to sit back and reflect on it. There's a term that you've used when you talk about reinventing the enemy's language and reappropriating language. You've used the term Blendian, and I'm curious about that term.
Well, that actually isn't my term. Someone else used that term. I'm more of a, that gets into the question of hybridity, of hybrid. In my own view, I'm more of a nationalist. I believe in finding your tribal roots and reestablishing your tribal roots. The the Blendian, it speaks to pan-Indianism.
Right.
And you know that's a respectable point of view. But I am more interested in particular tribal roots and tribal language. Language is my great fascination. And I love languages. And so I'm more concerned of finding my own tribal roots and relearning and rediscovering that from a cultural standpoint and less from a racial standpoint. There's a great film called Lone Star. I see heads nodding. Excellent film. John Sayles' film, Chris Cooper, Elizabeth Peña, Chris Christopherson. And it's one of the first pictures that I've seen where they talk about the Black Seminoles. And it's a very, he talks about all the racial groups in that part of Texas. You've got Anglo, you've got Mexicans, you've got African Americans, you've got Black Seminoles, and you've got Indians. And how he mixed all this together for a coherent story, it's a really, and then there's the love interest that even complicates that. It's almost like a Greek tragedy. So that's a very important story. But I am attracted to languages, and it's interesting that when I was a kid, I went to the library, in the Buffalo Public Library, and sometimes something just jumps out at you. And the book that jumped out at me was by Crazy Horse. And he became my hero, still my hero. And I became acquainted with the Lakota language by the phrases in his book, which I can still recall vividly. And the idea that the names are often mistranslated, Tashunka Witko in Lakota, it doesn't mean crazy horse. It means his horses are crazy. And what this meant, that he was so brave that when his enemy see his horses, not even see him, just see his horses, they're afraid. And when I was out in Sioux country some years ago, the land just spoke to me. These words, they came back to me. It was one of those tremendous experiences. And it's the language that really sticks with me. I mean, I can't shake off the Lakota language and always playing with it. And one of the phrases that I'll use when we close the formal part, is changing from Seneca to Lakota, is this phrase now that's big in Indian country, is called Mitakuya Oyasum. Some of you know that as to all my relations. And I play around with that phrase because I have trouble with saying my relations. I break it into the component. Mita means me. Kuye, that which is. Oyasin, all. And I like to translate that as to all that is related to me, rather than my relations, which is possessive. And I don't feel that that's a proper attitude, that when you stand and you say Tunkashla, in Shima la Yelo, Oyate Zan in Chimpelo, Hawaya Kielo, Heche Lena Oyate Nipitilo, Tunkashla, Pilama Ya Yelo, which is a prayer which is adapted from the sun dance that says, Grandfather, you make me, have pity on me, that these people want long life, so therefore I send you a voice that they may have long life. Grandfather, you make me grateful. And this, I say, Mintakwe Oyasin, goes out to all that is related to me. And the language has, and I'm trying to put names on places, as we were saying before, that in Vine Deloria Jr., who I knew, made the point in many times that for the European world, the Western world, it's history, things happening in time. The Native world is things happening in place. Mm-hmm. It's geography that's important. And the names that are on the places, like everyone's heard of Wounded Knee. Well, anytime Lakota hears Wounded Knee, remembers the story of the particular warrior who was there, he was wounded in his knee. So the land becomes alive, it's not a commodity.
Right.
And nothing is a commodity.
That's right. To really remember the land, and that's where you started us also tonight. It's a powerful piece to remember that with all of the stories that it comes from the land and it speaks to us. So I thank you for
I think that since we're on this Turtle Island, and Native people were generally very inclusive, they were very eager to bring people in of different backgrounds. They brought in people because they had special gifts. Racism was learned, it had to be learned. But they brought people in who brought in special gifts in order for them to survive. And they would rather make a relative than make an enemy, which makes sense.
That's wise. I want to open it up to the floor also, because I know that there are, I would assume there's questions. I'd like to invite people to come up to the microphone, and if you have questions, things that you want to ask so that we can continue this dialogue, I'd ask for you to keep them brief and pointed as a question. But if you can go to the mic, because we're being webcast tonight and people won't be able to hear it if you're not at the mic.
Eastern Tennessee region kicked out a bunch of black people. Is anything truth to that?
Well, I think it was in Oklahoma.
In Oklahoma?
Yeah, and it's an ongoing controversy. We would do a whole conference on that, or what happened. The Seminoles also had another bout of disenfranchising people. And in fact, it's even broader than that. Some of the casino groups have also disenrolled people. We get into tribal politics, and that's a very special area. And since I'm not Cherokee, I'm reluctant to.
But these were people who were the necessary 1/16th, and they were.
Well, the Dawes Commission was, like a lot of things in Indian country, was a travesty. What do I mean by a travesty? There were people of African ancestry who were Cherokee by blood, and they were on the former rolls up until the Dawes Act. Then when the Dawes Act came, they conducted ethnic cleansing. They put everyone who had or was perceived to have any African ancestry. There's a case of a woman who was 1/8 black, and she was denied enrollment on the by blood roll and put on something called the freedman roll, even though she had never been a slave. And for the freedmen, they didn't record any blood quantum at all. And so these people are hard pressed to go back to show that they are also Cherokee or Seminole by blood, because it was erased. Mm-hmm. And that was a travesty committed by the Dawes Act.
I hate to say thank you for the answer.
Hmm.
Sheol Norkley.
You
know, we've known each other for a long time, and I'm with you. Language is very important, no matter what your nation is. I want to give thanks to you and Gabrielle for opening up this door and dissolving the mystery of blood quantum.
Mm-hmm.
For me, as a Native person coming from North Carolina, my family's from North of South Carolina, it's always been that, well, you aren't light enough, you aren't this characteristic. And knowing Native people, it was never about that. So I'm glad for the clarity. And I just want to encourage everybody here who has Native blood, whatever nation you are, learn your language, because language separates you from English, it separates you from other tribes, and it gives you your own identity.
Okay, skill. And I think that you could say that English is actually a foreign language. And going to the place, there was an important town in eastern Tennessee with the interesting name of Nickajack. Anybody get the, okay?
Okay.
Heard the town of Nickajack. It was founded by a black Cherokee. He was the chief, and he was part of that group of Chickamaugas, and he sat in council, and his color and his ancestry did not detract from his leadership. So it's, again, it's the rewriting and writing out of people in history. Please.
My name is Zahum Anoushin. I'm Armenian.
Can you speak up, please?
I'm Armenian. I've done a lot of research on the Armenian genocide. And what I'd like to say is that I think it's very shameful that the United States government doesn't recognize the Native genocide or the African Holocaust genocide, and that when all this talk about blending of races, and you need to bring this up in different, take genocide conferences, and also talk about the effect of the rape of the conquerors on this very problem of blended races and stuff, because right now, the Native genocide is not listed in a lot of genocide books and conferences, and I hope you will include it in all your works.
Yes, okay, thank you very much.
Well, good evening. It's so good to see you. It's been a long time. My name is Ruth Hunt, and I am of Cherokee descent, and I'm a genealogist, and I've known this wonderful man for so many years of doing genealogy, and I just really want to encourage you all to continue that search, because I was very fortunate. I mean, you know, we have our oral history, and most of us know what our ancestry is because it's been passed down to us. But as a genealogist and a researcher, you know, you keep on searching, and every time I go south, because I'm born in Brooklyn, but my roots are Virginia, North Carolina, and Tennessee, which is Cherokee country. But I was able to find my Cherokee burial ground of my ancestors. So that was just a phenomenal experience, because you know a lot of these places have been changed, the names of the places have been changed. And so I did find the burial ground, and of course, speaking to Walter Pletchett, of course he genocized in the state of Virginia, all of the people would be either black or white, and no Native Americans. So when I found this burial ground, it said that it's a part of the United Methodist Church out of Methuen, Virginia, which is not on the map anywhere, because I went to Richmond looking for it. I found my great-great-grandmother's death certificate, and on her death certificate, it said where she was buried. And the people from that area of Saltville, Virginia, Glade Springs, Virginia, down the southwestern part of Virginia, near Bristol, Virginia, those people know, the people in that region know that there were Cherokee people there. Mm-hmm. And to go there and find the actual burial ground and to see, the oral history was that our people were buried around a huge oak tree. And to finally go to the Historical Society, as I said, I went to Richmond, no trace of Methuen, but some of the historical societies in these small towns, they know the history of the land. Right. And so I was able to locate this burial ground, and when I got there, this gentleman walked me over, and a lot of the Confederate soldiers are buried on this land now. Mm-hmm. But it said it was originally owned, it was originally the land of African Americans. But when I said to the man, no, these were Cherokee people. This was Cherokee land here. And when he turned and looked at me, he said, oh, you are Cherokee. Yes, it is. And look at the stream that's running alongside of this land. This is Cherokee country. Right. And it was a phenomenal feeling. And I mean, I was emotional, and I was in prayer to see the headstones of my people buried, you know, in a circle around the tree. I'm still looking for the significance of that.
Yeah.
But all of the headstones were like tall, skinny headstones like little points on the top, but I just want to share that. I just want to say, continue to do your research, continue to do your connection. It is there. We are who we are. No one can tell us how many, whatever the degrees we are. No one can tell you that. You know who you are.
Thank you.
So I thank you.
And I would also add that when you do your research and you go in these places, you have to be careful. There have been a lot of fires. A lot of courthouses have been burnt down. And sometimes, and you do research, it's the funniest thing. You could be there from the time they open, and it's not until 4:45 that you find out what you're looking for. And you say, well, and you hand this to someone and says, well, keep this out, don't refile this. I'll be back tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock to get it. And you go back and that person's gone and that record's gone.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of monkey business going on. So just be prepared for some those kinds of heartbreaks. But if you can, take plenty of money and make as many copies as you can and get your copies notarized at the place. They'll come in handy. Because, you know, evidently sometimes they will have disappeared and you may have the only excellent copy. Yes, please.
Yes, I'd like to preface my question with a Stevie Wonder song, If There's a Hell Below, We All Gonna Go.
Mm-hmm.
And the necessity to commit manifest destiny suicide. It seemed that like with the African and indigenous population, they are matriarchy centered, but we're living in a patriarchy dominated society. So we need to like really reconsider it, look at gender, because it's genocide, the false belief that male are superior and female are inferior, that drive this entire country and world into chaos and madness.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, very good.
Ni Willamase, Ni Nshinzi, Richard Wolf Paul. I'm a member of the Ramapo Lenape Nation. We're located up in the mountains of, up in Rockland County. Mm-hmm. I happen to be the sub chief in Staten Island. But when you talk about genocide, if you've seen things on TV like Mann versus Ford, where they've been killing my people, my cousin was shot and killed up in Mahwa, New Jersey, about 4 or 5 years ago.
Yes.
Yeah. So genocide is still taking place. Mm-hmm. It's alive and well. Again, with the Ringwood, New Jersey, Ford, they have been dumping their sludge in our area. Our children, our cousins are walking around with leukemia. So again, read up. Again, language is important. I just started learning mine. I started, and it's so important. You feel so good about yourself when you know who you are. So again, we're fighting the fight up in Rockland County, Paterson, New Jersey, Staten Island, New York, where I happen to live. But again, it's a pleasure to be here. And I would say, we say thank you in two ways. In Oklahoma, our cousins in Delaware, they say Wanishing, but up this way we say Anishik.
Okay.
But what I will have to do is learn to say what you said before. Instead of using the word thank you, what was the other word?
I am grateful.
I am grateful. So again, I'm just glad to be here amongst you. I happen to be blessed. I'm an architect. I raise some children. And I do things in a good way. Mm. And we follow the red road. Thank you. Thank
you. Okay. I'd like to comment on what you've just said, that in my classes, I insist that all my students learn at least one word in the group that they're going to study, and that word is thank you, I'm grateful. Mm-hmm. I insist that they be able to know that word, because it's a word that they ever meet those people that they'll have a great use for. Mm. And on your second point, it was a documentary on the Little Bighorn. I'm a buff a Little Bighorn. I say, I'm never going to read another book on it. And the next book comes out, and I read it from cover to cover. But there was a document, you hear the story that there were no survivors of the Little Bighorn. Well, I can name half a dozen just off the top of my head. And they interviewed a Sioux descendant, and he says, no, we don't hate the soldiers who rode against us, because like us, they were warriors. Ah, but the ones who sent them are still alive.
Mm. Mm.
It is my pleasure to be able to greet you, Brother Dixon.
Thank you.
I am of Seminole and Cherokee descent. And just recently, actually, this has been going on most of my life. I've met individuals like this. The first person was from the Pequot tribe of Foxwood. And I first looked at him, and I thought, okay, this person is having ideas of grandeur, because he was a very dark complexioned man from the island of, I believe, Bermuda. And he told me, yes, he told me that he was a descendant of, you know, and I looked at him, well, if this is the case, he said he went to, this was before they even found out, he went to the reservation and they all looked at him as if he was crazy, okay? I don't know if this gentleman decided to show up. I asked him to come here. He told me that he was a descendant of a chief. They escaped from North or South Carolina on boats, and they were ushered into the also the same island, Bermuda, and where this area, there's a place called Cherokeeville in the West Indies. And he said he was the descendant of a particular chief or warrior who they were trying to kill, especially Jackson, and they were ushered off. I've also met Puerto Ricans who have the same exact story of their escape from the United States into different Caribbean islands. I wanted to know, have you done extensive research on that situation as well? There are so many people that I have run into. I don't know why I meet them.
Yeah, okay. You're supposed to meet them.
Yes, and they have stories that are just absolutely fabulous. One Puerto Rican family had adopted two young girls who were saved from the United States, and they were brought there. They couldn't speak any of the language. They couldn't even understand. And I met this young lady, and she's her great-great-great-great-grandmother escaped, and they were brought over to Puerto Rico. And these are stories that need to be told, because when they say that they are of a certain tribe in the United States and they happen to be brown, they're treated very badly or they're laughed at.
That's right.
And I wanted to bring that subject
okay.
up.
Okay,
do you have a response?
Let me just respond to you.
Okay.
Okay, the Indian slave trade in this country was big.
Yes.
Until recently, there's been hardly a line of history written about it. They take 1619 as the jumping off point for the beginning of American slavery. Indian slavery in the US at that time was very, very old.
I'm aware.
Okay. It continued all the way up until the Emancipation Proclamation, because as the tribe, the Waukaman Siouan, the tribe of South Carolina, they have in their literature that on the day of the Emancipation Proclamations, Indians as well as Negroes walked off those plantations. Now, Charleston was a big slave center. If you go to Charleston today, you see the old slave market, not a mention of the hundreds and thousands of Indians that were sold through Charleston. They went to Massachusetts, New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Bermuda, Barbados, and the rest of the West Indies.
Yes.
So they were still going out. Okay. In terms of connection with these Seminoles, and I'm glad you mentioned the Seminoles. The Seminoles had relationships with people in the Bahamas and Cuba. And Rosalind Howard, my wife and I just met last month in Florida. She's documented some of the Seminoles, black Seminoles, that settled in Red Bay's Andros Island in Bahamas. She made many trips there. There was the so-called Spanish Indians who were south of Tampa. They were intermarried with Cuban fishermen. And they also would go from that area to Key West and to Havana. There was a group of Seminoles that settled, we know specifically in Guanabacoa, Havana, Cuba. So there is this information that's coming out. Lots of Indians were sent to the Caribbean, Bermuda, the Bahamas, the Northeast United States, and in the 1830s, during the colonization movement, many of them even went to Liberia and went to Africa.
I thank you for that, and I just want to say one other little thing. All of us here are of different backgrounds. We really need to come together, forget about all the tiny little isms, so that we can bring about our identity, come together for our health, for our children, for our economic upliftment, because there's a little bit too much because of this situation that we've all been put in. Mentally, there are a lot of us who, because we say who we are, we go through a lot of mental hardship. Our children, because of identity, are expected to act like they want us to act. So the only thing I just want to say is that through people like yourself and all of us here who have struggled, myself, I've been struggling with this for at least 25 years in terms of struggling for my identity and as well as others. I just want us all to come together as a more unified group. And that's all I have to say.
Okay, thank you.
So we want to make sure that everybody has a chance to see the exhibit upstairs and be able to buy a catalog if they'd like. So we're going to have two more questions, and then we're going to have everybody go upstairs. Okay.
Okay.
Good evening. My name is Cynthia Fountain. My question, sir, is what's your earliest remembrance or acknowledgement to yourself that you were Native? You know, that's what I'd like to hear, sir.
Your early childhood is as far back as I can remember. I can't remember anything else. I used to go to the movies. I used to root for the Indians. my grandmother, who was Indian, she was my co-conspirator. We pretended it was for the Boy Scouts, but she used to make my costumes for me. I used to make my own headdresses. And I used to try to sing the songs, and a friend of mine who I've talked to recently, he says, we always thought you were singing that. He says, I thought that was really cool that you were singing those Indian songs from a child before. And then when I read Crazy Horse, it solidified. And then everything else has been on this path, and things have been falling into place. I was lucky in 1977, I asked the eldest members of my family on both sides. They wrote me letters, and they provided me with a roadmap. And I've been able to document, and I tell people, Dan Carroll, document, because you may know it, you may feel it, but if you want to be taken seriously, you have to be serious about what you do. And so, and when you can show that document, and I look at a treaty, for instance, Sycamore Shoals, and on that treaty, there's a Leonard Henley Bullock, there's a Richard Henderson, and there's a Tillman Dixon. Now, Leonard Henley Bullock, direct ancestor. Richard Henderson had relationships with my family. So when you start seeing these names pop up, that's why you should do your genealogy so you know what you're looking for. It may be serendipitous, that is, you might not know what you're looking for, but you'll know it when you find it. And so that's what I would recommend. But that's my earliest recollection. I've always had that. Thank you.
Good evening, my brother.
Good evening.
Peace. I would like for you to speak to blackness being an indigenous quality or aspect to the lives of most people around the earth. In other words, in Native America, you had a quality of blackness. Somehow, some way, from my research, we all have evolved from a common ancestry, and it has been said that that has happened from Africa, but that may have been millions of years ago. But in spite of that, a physiological mutations have occurred, and people have spread to other parts of the earth for millions of years. So blackness really is an indigenous quality to who the people are in America, in Japan, in Europe, all over the earth. So I would like for you to speak to that, because I had a quote from Christopher Columbus, and he said when he came to these shores, "Oh, wow, either my boat has taken a wrong turn and we wound up in Africa, or the Africans beat us here. The Moors were also here." So may you speak to that piece.
Okay, let me just say this. There's a great deal of discomfort out there among a lot of people, because it's pretty well accepted by at least the scientific community that the species of Homo sapiens originated in Africa. And that the African genes are the dominant genes, the dark skin, dark hair, what have you. These are the dominant. And as you talked about the mutations toward lighter skin, lighter eyes, and lighter colored hair were mutations. My wife and I were watching television the other night, last night in fact, and seeing the people in Fiji. Do you know about the people in Fiji? Okay, they're the ones that had the Afro hairstyle in Fiji, in the South Pacific. The New Guineans, the Aborigines in Australia, there's a whole band across the whole continent of Asia. You got the Negritos in the Philippines. Mm-hmm. You have the Andaman Islanders in Thailand and people places like that. And it was the Andaman people who knew the tsunami was coming, and they sought high ground. They did a study in India, southern India, and found the African strain among the original inhabitants of India. And there's also some interesting stories that some of the Spanish explorers talked about the people in California, native people in California, who they describe as being black. So there's a lot of work that needs to be done, and there are lots of tantalizing clues out there that we can't quite conclude anything yet, but it's interesting. And these things have been swept under the rug. I mean, most people have heard about the Ptolemaic statues with the African features and how they've tried to argue away from that. We know that people were journeying. People were crossing the oceans. They're crossing the Atlantic Ocean before Columbus. They were crossing the Pacific Ocean before Thordal. And so these things are very possible. If people reached the Pascua Island, Easter Island, from the Pacific, couldn't they have also reached other places in the Americas? So there are lots of tantalizing clues mm-hmm. out there, and we need to be vigilant and continue our research.
Thank you.
Okay, so I will say mitakwe oyasun to all my relations.
Thank you. And I would like to truly thank you. I'd like to thank also Kathy Dixon for being here and accompanying us on this journey as well. There's a lot to learn. There's a lot of work we need to do. I think that the energy in this room has been absolutely beautiful tonight. I think there's a spirit rising here that's been coming for a long time, and it's very present. It's truly a privilege to sit here with you and take this journey of crossing with you. And I think there's a lot more out there where mm-hmm. we need to go. So with that, I'd like to thank you. Welcome all of you to our reception upstairs. We'll have some more time to talk, to share, to converse, and figure out where we're going. Thank you.